So yesterday we did a workshop that talked a little bit about analysis. We also looked at some composition there too. But yeah, let's talk a bit about your final project. So of the, let's see, five of you that are here, does anybody want to share anything that's a work in progress right now? Where are all of us at? I'm curious. And it can be at any stage of development, even if you haven't really started yet. If you just want to talk through the process, that's also fine too.
I guess I can share mine.
Okay, sure, go ahead, Natalie. Oh, actually, let me give okay, you should be able to share the screen now. Okay, so did you share audio by chance too?
I think. How do I check?
Well, let's see. Go ahead and just try playing it and let's see if we can hear it.
All right. Could you hear that?
No, I couldn't. So at the top, there should be a button that says share options or something like that. And on mine, it's on the right side, and there's a drop down that says share sound on there.
Okay. Could you hear
Yeah,
that?
yep,
Okay,
I can hear
great.
that.
All right. Well, here's mine.
Cool. Yeah, thanks for sharing. Yeah, I like the way that you have this organized with a bit of a like an introduction, a middle portion, and then kind of the introduction material comes back at the end. And I also like that you experimented with some seventh chords in there throughout. So do you want to kind of talk about the process a bit? Did you start with chords, start with melody?
I started with the chords,
Okay.
and I kind of just clipped the staff randomly and then moved the notes around until it sounded decent.
Okay, cool. I mean, that's also a fine way to do it. Yeah, whether doing that on the software or actually just like plinking around on like a keyboard and figuring things out. Yeah, great. So what kind of did you encounter any kind of problems throughout or any sort of I don't know, were there any sort of situations where you felt kind of stuck and you needed to try to figure out how to proceed, or was it generally smooth throughout?
It was generally smooth throughout.
Okay.
I don't know. Writing the melody was the hardest part because I don't know how to do that.
Oh sure. No,
But
I think
yeah.
that you do a good job of, so you started with a simpler melody and then it got more rhythmically complicated as it went throughout. I think that that's a great way to do it. So, yeah, is that basically completely finished, or are you just have any revisions planned?
I mean it's done, but I'd like to hear your feedback.
I mean, sure. Do you mind actually sharing the screen again just so I can look at it?
Oh yeah.
No, I mean, I think that this is honestly like if you were to submit this, I think that it's solid as is. And it's one of those things we talked about this a little bit yesterday, where if you're given an infinite amount of time to write something, you could spend all the time in the world working on it. So, yeah, I like the chord progression at the beginning, and I like how you've got kind of one chord and then changes to the next with kind of having those. I'm looking at measure two, for instance. So the top two notes, the G goes down to a G flat and the B flat goes up to a C, which is kind of a cool effect of taking relatively similar chords, but by changing them subtly, kind of making that change more gradual. It's a pretty cool process. We talked about like the voice leading chords concept last week. So it's kind of like that. I would say that I like how consistent your left hand is very supportive throughout. So I think that you said that you had a hard time with melody, but I think you did a good job of creating a melody that is supported by whatever chord you had in the left hand. And then breaking up those chords into arpeggios, I think is a really nice way to kind of distinguish the texture in the beginning and the end with what's in the middle. Yeah, I mean, I think this is really solid. Does anybody else have anything they want to talk about in the chat or any other suggestions or feedback for Natalie? and it's okay if not. I think that, yeah, I think this is in a good spot. Can you scroll down a little bit for me, please?
Oh, yeah. I just
want to see the bottom part. Okay. So, yeah, great. Yeah, Natalie, that I think you did a really good job with this.
Thank you so much. Chat,
yeah, I liked how you didn't limit yourself to the staff and user range. Yeah, I like that too. So I think that at the end in like measure 15, where you double in octaves and earlier, that's like a really common and really solid effect for kind of creating interesting contrast with similar musical materials. So it's kind of a myth that every single measure needs to be unique and interesting. And like we talked about very briefly earlier this week, repetition is actually a really good way to make music coherent and you know, flexible. So yeah, nice work, Natalie. Thanks for sharing. I don't really have much to add. So good
work. Thank you so much.
Yeah, does anybody else have anything that they want to share? We've got some more people that have joined us. And like I said, while I'm recording right now, if anybody wants me to stop the record and just, you know, that's also fine too. So either way.
I already went yesterday, but I'd be happy to go again.
Sure. Yeah. We can chat about your piece again.
Cool. I changed a few things.
Okay, great.
Okay.
So this is, yeah, take two, right? Okay. I unfortunately can't hear that. Did you share sound by chance?
I did, but this is...
Yeah, that problem happened yesterday too. Yeah, we can do the same solution as yesterday if you'd like. That's no problem.
Okay, yeah. Give me just a moment then.
So for those of you who weren't here yesterday, so Andolyn shared her... she had like three different versions that she was working on of three different kind of pieces. And this is the second one. She was experimenting with writing for piano accompaniment with voices. So Andolyn was playing around with the voice feature on MuseScore and kind of playing around with that. And then we talked a bit about ways to kind of keep your melody and your harmony distinct while still flowing together smoothly. Although we did have some audio issues, which is why she's got to email me her file. Any second now. Sorry for the wait, everybody. Something I will say is if anybody here, yesterday we did, because we had some people that were working on the composition component, we did talk a little bit about composition yesterday. So if you ended up doing analysis and couldn't join us yesterday, feel free to share. We could talk about some analysis at the end too, if you'd like. All right, should be so. Okay, great. Looking for it now. There we go. Okay, give me just a moment. MuseScore is opening up. Okay, here we are. So can we all hear this? Thank you. So for these, for B and for A, are these chords? Are these lead sheet symbols here? Or are these?
Those are chords that I put in.
Okay, cool, cool. Yeah, so yesterday we looked at this first part here. I like that you've kind of added a second, and in this case, a third voice part, which I think is kind of nice. It gives you some different types of motion. We didn't talk about this in class, but in a supplemental video I did, I talked a little bit about types of motion in voice leading. So you've got some things like that, which are kind of nice, where your voice part splits off, and as one part goes in one direction, the other part goes in an opposite direction, which is a pretty easy way to make your music more interesting while still staying within your chords. I also like how there's parts where the accompaniment drops out. Is the accompaniment going to stay dropped out, or is this just not
really? I tried a few things. I tried to support it in a few different ways, but I didn't like any of the ways that I came up. So I was considering maybe just leaving it like that there. Mm-hmm. I kind of like it. I don't know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I think that it gives some nice contrast. And we talked yesterday about rhythm and how in general there's a very strong quarter note sense in this piece. Mm-hmm. So I think that breaking up the accompaniment will actually help to kind of you've established such a solid beat throughout, mm-hmm, that then when it drops out, it creates anticipation for when it comes back. Let's look at, I'm curious with this. So you have the chord here. I'm curious if what it would be like if we actually wrote out the chord in the left hand instead of having the lead sheet symbol do the work, because there's some kind of interesting ways that we can do this. So you have an F chord here, right? It's an F chord in first inversion. Actually, let me make this a little bit bigger. It's a little small. So a B chord to an F chord is actually a pretty substantial distance. They're not chords that are commonly associated with each other, but that actually makes it a really interesting progression. So something that I would do is, like, they are such jarringly different chords that you want to try to connect them as smoothly as possible. So you've already kind of got that where B goes up to C. And that happens here as well. So we can think about this in other voices too, where we can have, oh, whoops, my mistake. Where we can have, say, F sharp. Oh, whoops. We can have F sharp go down to F natural, for instance. Oh, come on now. Sorry, music chord is a little finicky. And we can either have the B go down to an A in the bass, or do something like this. Let's do that. Which we could have just written here, but oh well. So that gives us something like this instead. Actually, I'm just gonna quickly delete that just so we can hear it without the chord symbol. So even though that it's a B chord going to an F chord, which is a pretty jarring distance, because we've got a step here, a half step here, a half step here, mm-hmm, and there's not anything here. I mean, the D sharp is going to be a weird note anyways, but that's kind of okay. Something like this can make it smooth. There's other options too. There's other ways to voice this. And also adding a rhythmic component could also make this smoother. It doesn't need to be smooth either. It could be joined if you want, but it seems like everything else here is relatively like melodically very smooth.
Yeah.
So you can take that approach with your chords as well. So it's just an idea. I'll put the B back. So yeah, how did you yesterday this part wasn't written. So how did you write this part here?
My method with this entire thing was just see what happens and like try something. I don't know, I just kind of like put some notes down and I was like, okay, I feel like that would go to this, or I just thought that it would sound nice if I, like, I don't know, it just happened.
Yeah. So for people that compose with like a melody forward approach, or mm-hmm, or even just like, I'm just going to write something and then figure it out. Something that you can actually do that's a very good exercise is to actually analyze your own music.
Yeah.
And what I mean by that is, and this is true for anybody that's composing like this, where instead of going like, I want this chord, then this chord, then this chord, if you're doing everything on instinct, you can go, okay, well, B and D, that could be maybe a G chord of some kind, or it could be maybe a B minor chord of some kind. And then here you've got, later on, you've got an E minor chord. So you can actually think of like the chords that you're implying. This is kind of like, ooh, what is that? This is kind of like a G7 question mark. Another A minor chord. And the reason why I'm doing this is because that by looking at just where your melody is naturally gone, if you did decide that you wanted to flesh this out, not that you need to, we talked about how there's good reasons to not do that. But if you did want to, you actually have kind of given yourself a chord progression here.
Okay.
So hypothetically, and this is just for the sake of argument here, let's just do, we'll just do this all in root position. We'll do this, I don't know. Yeah, it's fine. So we'll do that, and then let's just do... Okay, sorry, what I just did very quickly is I took the chords that were implied by your melody, and there's more options than just this, of course. I put them all in root position, which is pretty boring, but it gets the job done for right now. And then I very quickly just wrote them in a way where they all kind of flow one to another. So what that would sound like is this. So again, I have given this no rhythm, and there's different ways that might be more interesting to voice this with different inversions or adding seventh chords or whatever. But this is kind of both, Andolin, for your piece, but also for anybody else who's looking to write a melody and then accompany it. You know, you can just kind of follow the melody and just see what happens, and that might create something interesting. So yeah, I don't know if you have any thoughts on kind of this process. I don't know how, I don't remember, how did you get your accompaniment yesterday?
I think that I started with the harmony, and then I just kind of like chose pitches out of there.
Right.
Yeah.
So this is basically the opposite then. This is kind of having the melody and then picking the harmony from that. So yeah. Which is cool, because even by doing this, it's still, because it's your melody and your harmony, this still sounds like your piece.
Yeah.
Even though I just created something in like 15 seconds. So
yeah.
Just an idea. For instance, and it, like I said, there's a lot of merit to this actually not having any accompaniment, because it's a wonderful textural difference. But if you were going to go back and do something like this, this is kind of an option. So yeah, with the new material, is there anything that you wanted to talk about or that you wanted to kind of ask questions about since we looked at this yesterday?
Anything other than... Not like big questions. There's definitely still a lot of things that I want to try.
Sure.
But that will probably just be me, you know, tinkering around with things for a long while.
Oh, sure. I mean, I think looking at the new stuff that you've written, I think that my biggest takeaway is to maybe go back through and modify some rhythms here and there, especially in your melody. And honestly, it could be as simple as just adding dots in certain places, like adding a dot and shortening the next note, or adding ties. Like, it actually is not that complicated of a process to add more rhythmic variety. Although, like I said, I think that having a strong pulse is also not something to turn your nose against either. So,
So with the rhythmic variety, you would suggest that I keep that in the voice rather than the accompaniment?
It depends. I think that if you don't want to necessarily change everything, because it can become too complicated and too busy of a texture.
Right.
I think if you're going to change one thing, it should you either change the melody or change the accompaniment. I would not change both.
Yeah, I tried to do like a few different things, but it just kept sounding really crunchy to me.
Sure.
So I'll try that and see how that sounds.
So an example of what I mean would be something like this. We're just doing something simple, like making this a dotted note and then just changing that.
Okay.
Like this is it literally could be as simple as this, because now we've offset the beat and right. It stands out from the accompaniment, right? It's just something a little different to give it a little more variety, even though the pitches are the same.
Okay.
So cool. Yeah, and like I said, you might play with it and decide that you don't want to do that, which is also fine too.
We'll see. I think I told you yesterday that I get into a habit of like, I feel like I make things more complicated for myself than it should be. And even in my quest to make it simpler, somehow it gets more jumbled. Mm-hmm. So I'm trying to find a balance there.
Oh, sure. Sure. No, I mean, and like I mentioned in class earlier this week, it's like setting restrictions on yourself can be really useful. So again, if you get to a point where you're like, I just don't have time for rhythm right now, totally fine. And honestly, mentioning that in the write-up is what the write-up is for. You could say like, I really wanted to play with this. Rhythm became too much of a hassle, so I decided to keep simple rhythms to more explore melody and harmony and things like that. So cool. Totally fine. Yeah. Anything else that you want to look at with this?
No, I think I'll just go in and try some new things with it.
Yeah, great. Great. Yeah, thanks for sharing again.
Yeah, thank you. I appreciate it.
Okay, so does anybody else want to share anything? Works in progress, pieces they want to talk about, anything's fair game. There's a bunch of people here that I haven't heard from at all today or yesterday. So what do you guys got? Oh yeah, sure. I mean, yeah, if you want to share again, that's your prerogative. Yeah, we did speak in office hours about it, but has anything changed substantially since you stopped by? Not really. No, that's fine. Yeah, I mean, if you want to share just for your peers' sake, that's fine. And if you don't, that's cool too. So
I think mainly it's just like I don't know if it's like I feel like it's done, but then I don't know if there's anything else I should do or can do.
Sure. Do you want to share your screen? We can look at it again.
Okay.
That's okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Having a kind of a composition cohort can be a bit nerve wracking, but it's usually pretty, we're all welcoming folks here. So, okay. Yes. I remember this piece. Yeah. Great. Let's just go ahead and take a listen to it first. Yeah, I think this is in a really good place. I like that there's a lot of polish to it. And what I mean by that is that it seems like the ideas that I hear you going for seem to kind of come to fruition. And there's a really nice sense of form with this piece, with the two repeated sections, a little intro, a little conclusion, and then kind of a transition in the middle. And I like that you're playing around with exploring the ambiguity between keys. So even though that you go to a C major section, it never really feels like we've fully arrived in C major because we don't really ever hear C major. And I find that that's a really interesting with kind of, it allows you to change to C major, but it doesn't really betray the kind of somber quality of this. And I also like how you kind of, you keep that left hand kind of motif going throughout, which allows you a lot of kind of freedom with your melody. And you've kind of intuited some really interesting concepts, like in measure 8, where you hold the D over from the previous measure and then resolve it. That actually has its own name in music. It's called a suspension. Basically, you're holding over what was a chord tone into the next measure when it becomes a non-chord tone, and then you resolve it. It's a pretty common and really gorgeous sound, but we just didn't have time to talk about it. So yeah, I think that this is in a really good place. So thank you for sharing. Do you have anything that you kind of want to talk about? I know that we chatted briefly in office hours this week, but
I'm just like, I guess the thing is like the left hand, it is like a motif, right? Sure. Like you said, but it also does feel like it's a bit repetitive. If that's like something that I should change, or it's like something that, you know, should just be left there.
I mean, so there's a lot that goes into what makes something recognizable. So the chords constantly change. So it's not that the pitch is consistent, but there's really, let's call it two things that make this left-hand motif recognizable. The rhythm, one and two and the contour, the kind of shape of the line where it goes down, up, that kind of zigzag pattern. So a way that you could keep the same rhythm and to vary the motif without compromising its recognizability is there are some spots where, you know, you've got this, it's an octave, a fifth, and then you go to the third, which is a really solid way to fill out your chord. But for instance, try playing around with flipping the direction. So instead of going down, up, you can try going up, down, and do the same notes, but just play with the octave. So it'll keep the mode of sounding recognizable, but it'll give it some variety. It's a really simple change, but that might actually be just enough to change it up for you.
Yeah, I think, yeah, that sounds like a good idea.
Yeah. You know, actually, a good place to do that might be when you go to C major, because the section is already so different anyways, that you can just play around with changing the left hand there. Because when you go back to C minor, the left hand is completely different. And then when it returns at the very, very end, your little coda section, it kind of returns back to normal, so to speak.
Okay, that's actually something I do want to try in here.
Yeah. Yeah. So yeah, thanks for sharing. Yeah, I really appreciate it. So this is, this is really nice. This is really solid work.
Okay.
So
thank you. Nice job.
Does anybody else want to share anything? We don't have to go the whole time if we don't want to, but the floor is yours. This is the last day of class basically. So anything you guys want to talk about, final project wise, analysis wise, I will also take questions on the final exam, but I can't imagine that there's anything that's not self-explanatory, but I'm happy to help.
I have a really quick question about the write-up that goes along with the composition.
Sure.
You talked about like the integrity of musical writing more so with like the analysis piece. I would assume that with our like little write-up that goes with our composition, it's the same kind of like, you definitely want it to be like an academic piece of writing.
Yeah.
You want us to be analyzing our piece in the same way, or should it be more focused on how we went, like our journey of writing it, if that makes sense?
I think a combination of both is fine, because in order to talk about your process of writing it, you'll have to talk about things that are analytical. So saying like, I wanted to figure out this chord progression, I ended up on this. I wanted to figure out this melody, I came up with this in measure so-and-so. In the lectures, I did focus a lot more on the writing aspect, on the analysis portion, because the analytical paper, the whole project is really the paper. So it's longer, but yeah, you're right. The process for writing the shorter write-up for composition should be similar. You want it to be, it's formal in structure, even if like you're talking about things that are subjective, that are your, like, I did this, I did that. So you don't have to say like, you could use first person tense, you could use a more conversational tone. But you still want to make sure that it's not just like, I was sitting on a sunny day and I wrote this piece. Like, you want it to still have details, as if you were writing like an analysis of your own piece, so to speak. It's just, it's much shorter because the meat of the composition option is definitely the actual composition itself. So.
Got it. Thank you.
Yeah. No worries. Other questions? Logistical questions? Anybody want to share anything else? There's a couple people here that I still haven't heard from that I would like to, but there's no pressure. I don't want to put you on the spot. I have an arrangement I'd like to get your ideas on. Oh, no, we can do that. We can talk about arrangement. Jane, am I remembering correctly that this is an a cappella arrangement?
Yeah, it is. But I don't want to take up time if other people want to.
Okay. We still have a half hour even still. No, yeah, definitely. Let's hear it.
So it's very much so in its opening legs. Mm-hmm. I'm still working on it, so I can share my screen, but.
Oh, just for some context for everybody. So Jane is asked permission to do an arrangement of a piece instead of an original composition, because you're gonna use it for a group on campus, is that right?
Yeah.
Yeah, but also we talked about, so we didn't talk about arrangement that much in class, but arrangement is basically just taking a piece that exists and then reconfiguring it for your own creativity. And Jane is trying to add a lot more of her own,
which is definitely what I need your help on, because right now I feel like it's very boring. The entire song is like four chords.
Sure.
So it's also in A minor, which mm-hmm. is basically C.
Sure.
So I've had a little bit of trouble with that just because it feels really boring. So I just want you to look at it and tell me what's
sure. All right.
Fiddling with. Okay, cool. So tell me if you can hear this. That's basically it.
Sure. Yeah. Let's go back to the beginning. So I think in general,
it's got a lot of gaps because I just haven't been able to flesh a lot of it out yet. So
sure. No, that's okay. Yeah. I mean, this is the blessing and the curse of four chords is that on the one hand, it's hard to make it sound distinct over and over again. But on the other hand, because you're doing the same chord progression over and over and over, it's mm-hmm. much easier to vary certain things. And what I mean by that is, you know what the chords are, you know what the notes in the chords are.
Yeah.
So, you know, there's that part where you've got like, people are repeating that same, different parts are repeating that same ascending third over and over again.
Mm-hmm.
But you can play around with just doing different chord tones, for instance. So, mm-hmm. so instead of it just being the same two notes in different voices, it could be, well, one voice has the original notes from the song, but then another voice has different chord tones and so on, and playing around with that. And yeah. You can also, you know,
is that here?
Yes. Yeah, exactly.
Cool. Yeah.
And I will say that like, reharmonization is an option. It just depends. It gets more complicated. The most common way that, you know, vocal tunes vary up repetition is by the last chorus through or something, they will do a key change. They'll either, they'll go up a whole step or something. So if you're in A minor or C, you go up to B minor or D, for instance. I will say,
I find that particularly cliche, but we could totally fiddle with that. Or I can
to be frank, it's extremely cliche, but it's cliche for a reason, because it does
make it interesting. Yeah.
It's an easy way to just like make it sound like the piece is ending and energize it. Mm-hmm. But you know, playing around with, it's hard to say because there's so many things you could do.
Right.
I do like the rhythmic sense you have throughout, like, especially, can you go back to like page 2 or 3?
Yeah, that's starting like here, right?
Yeah, I think that you do a really good job with that. I would say that the way that the bass is written is a bit, might be a bit confusing to.
Yeah, I'm gonna mess with that. I don't really like the bass.
I mean, I think that even if you keep the rhythms the same, I think that the way that it's written is a bit confusing, because having two dotted notes next to each other is pretty hard. So what I would do is do a dotted eighth note, tie it to a 16th note, and then a dotted eighth note, a 16th note tied to the next eighth note, because it shows where your beats are. Does that make sense?
Okay, so tied to the next eighth note here.
Yeah. Right back. See that? See how that's easier to read? Because now you can see where the beats are.
Yeah. Okay, cool.
So I'll
make that everywhere.
Yeah, I think that, so, and then I know that this is, I see it's a five parts.
Sorry.
No, that's okay. And then there's no beatboxer, right? So the rhythm's all just going to come from the...
Yeah, I'm going to have, well, our voice vocal percussionists just kind of do what they want, but I was going to have them come, because in the actual song, the beat comes in and out. So I was just going to show them like where it is in and where it's out.
Yeah, I think that that'll also will make this sound less empty.
Right.
Is having some, yeah. Yeah, so reharmonization. What are the four chords? I couldn't actually quite catch them.
I think it's like G, E minor, A minor, and F. I can double check that.
So it's like a 1-6-2.
Yeah. Here, okay. I was looking at that over here. What does it say? The bridge is E minor, A minor, G.
Okay.
And then it's C, D minor, A minor, F.
So 1-2-6-4. Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, when in doubt, you could take the same chords and play around with sevenths, for instance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
This is the thing. Like, if you change the chords too much, you'll start to sound like a different style, which can be cool, but it just depends if that's what you're looking for.
It might be.
Sevenths is what, like, instead of thinking of like an acapella with triads, acapella with sevenths is what makes it sound like vocal jazz, which might not be the exact sound you're going for, but like borrowing some of that harmonic language. So even just adding sevenths or adding a little bit of crunch, or you could just add notes elsewhere. So like if you have an A minor chord, adding a B to an A minor chord gives you a real crunch to it.
Yeah, I actually, that reminds me, I was having a lot of trouble with this section here last night, because the bass, like it starts at an E minor and then it wants me to change to an A here, and it just sounds so crunchy. So
can you play that for me?
Yeah.
Can you pause it?
Yeah.
So what? I didn't hear the crunchy. Like that didn't sound crunchy to me.
I changed it because I realized that it doesn't resolve to an A minor until here. So it wants me to put an A minor here, but I made it so that it didn't.
When you say it wants to, what do you mean?
So the actual song, the chord change is here.
Okay.
So it can we hear that? Like, yeah.
That doesn't sound crunchy to me.
Maybe it would sound different with voices. Like, maybe it wouldn't sound as crunchy on, like, with people.
Yeah, because, like, because, I mean, honestly, anything can work if you have the confidence with it, too. There's quite a lot of dissonant, like, it's because you've got the A against the G and the B. So you've got three notes all close together. Mm-hmm. Can you play it again for me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't. Yeah, I don't know. I don't mind it.
That's good.
I don't mind it. I think as long as the basses can get the fourth too, that'll be easy to sing. Because the reason why vocalists often avoid dissonance is because it can be hard to sing dissonance because your ear wants to naturally turn them into consonances.
Yeah.
Right. But in this case, because the alto and tenor are already singing the same pitches and they stay the same. This is dissonance created by one voice changing to make the dissonance, but the other two voices just have to stay consistent. So actually, this is a way to kind of create something a bit crunchier, but have it be easy to, like, not easy, but have it be more straightforward to sing. Because that's always the problem with writing for voice, is that the more intricate you make things like harmony and certain melody, it just becomes hard to sing in a way that's different than working with instruments, for instance. Yeah, I don't know. You can play around with it. I mean, I think that your change is also fine too. It's up to you. I don't think that that sounds inherently too crunchy. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I would say, do you listen to any particular, is there like an arranger or an arrangement or an a cappella group that you particularly like as like a model?
Kind of. One of my favorite a cappella arrangements is I'm blanking on their name now, but it's an all girls group and they do like an amazing arrangement of I Put a Spell on You.
Oh, and okay.
It's just so different from the actual song, and mm-hmm. I have no idea how to get from like point A to point B of like a song and then like an arrangement that sounds really unique and interesting. So
sure.
That's yeah.
Yeah, I mean, so let's think about that. I think that the first thing I usually change if I'm doing, because for instance, I've written some a cappella stuff before, but I've actually, most of my arranging history is with either marching band or with jazz groups. So in both cases, when writing for like a jazz group, if I'm trying to do an arrangement of a tune that exists for 70 years and I want to do something different, the first thing I change before I change anything else is the bass. Because usually the bass is going to be one of the more distinct and repetitive aspects of the original. So it gives you instant contrast by changing what the bass is. Now you may not necessarily want to do that, but like that could be an easy way to just make it sound different from the original. After the second thing I would do is think about like different harmonization or different texture. And like the thing about this particular tune is that it's got that kind of repetitive rhythm over and over again. Mm-hmm. So playing around with that rhythm and not necessarily, I think that leaning into it at the beginning is fine, but especially in the middle, like if this will make it easier on you, like if you think of the beginning and the ending as being like, I have taken the original tune and I have written it for a cappella group, but then make the middle section your own, that kind of is one of those ways to impose restrictions on you. So instead of just like, I need to change everything, it could be like, I need to change one section, for instance.
That's super helpful, because then it's less repetitive all the way through, which is one of our issues,
yeah,
you know, in a cappella arranging. So that's great.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So here's, and also like, so a cappella, like, and this has always been part of the reason why I think a cappella is so popular is because of the fact that in general, the arrangements for a cappella don't change much from the originals. Mm-hmm. But I do also think that the most interesting a cappella music is the a cappella music that does change the most from the originals. So it's kind of, you're working against the paradox. But as an example, this is not a cappella, what I'm going to play, but I just have...
stop sharing.
Yeah, sure. Sorry, I just thought of an example of like a way to think of an extreme rearrangement of a piece. Sorry, you'll have to indulge me all again with a jazz piece. I apologize. Can I do... No, not Google Lens. Sorry. Okay. Let me share my screen, and I'm going to play you a piece. We're not going to listen to the whole thing. So this is a piece called Footprints. I don't know if you can see this, right? Cool. So it's got a repetitive bass line. It's got a repetitive melody. It's a very simple, straightforward thing. It's kind of a blues. We talked about that. Anyways, I'm going to play for you the original version, and I'm going to play for you a completely different version. So it's as different from jazz to this new version. I'll save the spoiler for a second, as it is from like pop to a cappella. Okay, so I'm just gonna stop it there. My point is not to be like, let's talk about footprints. My point is we've got a meter, it's in 3/4. We've got a key signature, C minor. We've got a repetitive bass line that continues and a melody, right? So these are kind of the basic nuts and bolts of what makes this tune sound like Footprints. Here is a completely different arrangement where it's Footprints as a reggae. So it's a different meter. It's starting off in a different way. You've got different percussion in the background. It's a completely different type of group. And then they add an introduction that's not in the original. It's now completely different. And I don't mean to say that like your arrangement needs to be so different as this, but I guess it's the point of like, depending on how adventurous you are, you could change basically everything and have it still be the same tune. At the end of the day, all that really matters is the melody and the lyrics. You could change everything else and it'll still sound like the original Taylor Swift tune.
Sweet, thank you.
Yeah. So I would say that, you know, in terms of like what you're gonna do for this class, at least, like, talk about the process of arranging and like what you wanted to change, what you felt like you will change but haven't gotten to yet. But like I said, if you want to think of like just the middle of the tune as where you just go crazy and make it Jane's version, it's okay if the outsides are more familiar, because, you know, knowing your audience, an a cappella audience is going to like the recognizability and is going to like the change in the middle. It's like a great way to kind of bring the audience along with you on whatever wild experimentation you have while still keeping it rooted in what they're there for. So
sweet. No, that sounds great. I really appreciate it. And then when I turn it in, should I turn in the whole thing, or do you only want me to turn in a section of it?
I would turn in whatever.
Cause I can just turn in that middle part if I do, like if I end up working on that.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Let's say that. Yeah. Okay, let's say cool. That. Yeah. Yeah. Whatever you feel is the most kind of, original to your kind of creativity, I would submit that portion. And you could talk about like where this is coming from in the write-up, for instance. So
sweet.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah. Thanks for indulging me on the Footprints sidebar. It's just
that
like,
was really cool.
Those are just so extremely different, but they're the same melody, they're the same chords, like they're the same tune, but they're like night and day. So
no, it's why I love stuff like that where people just take old stuff and make it completely new. It's cool. Thank you.
Cool. So we've been at 50 minutes right now. Does anybody else want to share anything? Yeah, sure. Go ahead, Daniel.
Okay, four. So I have like two currently. So I'll share the first one.
Okay.
Is it sharing audio?
Yeah, I don't know if it's sharing audio. I can see your screen though. You're on flat.io, right?
Yes.
Cool. Okay, go ahead and try playing it and I'll see if I can hear it.
Can you hear it?
No, so I can hear it from your computer speakers, but not from... So yeah, in the top under share options or something, there should be a drop-down menu and share sound is on the drop-down menu.
Oh, got it, yeah. Okay. Oh, sorry.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, sure.
It's still not completely done though. It's like I find a way to end it for some reason.
No, I like a lot. Daniel, just so you know, I can hear myself coming back from your speakers. I like a lot how you begin with the melody. It's relatively simple in texture and it's really high. And as the piece goes on, it gets lower and then you add more chords and it gets more, or not more chords, but like you flesh out the chords, add different rhythms. I think that you do a really good job of taking an idea and kind of evolving it throughout. Something that I should say is for the left hand. So there's a couple places where you've got chords like thirds or triads, but really low on the keyboard. And normally when we're down below, we want to space things out a bit more because it sounds really dense if it's too close together. So maybe you could play around with inversions or different octaves or things like that. I think that it could be fine as is. I think that it's got this really lush, rich sound to it. But something that you could consider is spacing out the chords a bit or fleshing them out. And instead of doing thirds, you could do maybe fifths and then the third on top of that, for instance. In terms of how to end it, it seems like I would just do one more statement of the melody, but then instead of ending it on a minor chord, ending it on your tonic chord, and you could end it in maybe a lower register. So the whole piece is up high in the melody, and maybe at the end, the last statement is lower, and then it ends lower. And for instance, since you've gotten this increasingly amount of rhythmic complexity, maybe the last time through you simplify it again. So you start simple, complicated, simple. So that way it gives a kind of arc to your piece.
So from like measure 17, it's like another introduction. I mean, a theme of it. So would that be like the last one?
Yeah, it could be. I mean, like there's so many ways you could end the piece. I think that, so I noticed that you've got dynamics and you're getting quieter. So what you could maybe do is, since you've got this melody and you're descending in the right hand, you could maybe just leave the left hand out and finish the melody just in the right hand and then maybe just end it on a single note or something, right? So we start up high with chords, we get lower, denser chords in the left hand, it gets very rich and very wide. And then at the very end, it comes back down again and you could end on like a single pitch, for instance. Might be an idea.
What I originally did was like in the beginning, I had the right hand just playing.
Sure.
That's what I had intentionally, but it just didn't seem right for some reason. So
sure. I mean,
you could move that.
You could maybe come back to that idea for the ending, maybe. Because at the beginning, you know, you don't want, like, starting small at the beginning gives you a place to grow. But if you start too small, it sounds uncertain. And the way that you started here is, I think, very declarative and very, very assertive in a way that I think is good. So maybe revisit that idea for the ending.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so after, like, I was messing around with the end part, I couldn't get one to, like, find an ending. So I, for fun, made another one.
Mm-hmm.
Inspired by Beethoven's Moonlight Sonata.
Okay.
Okay. Oh wait, I should turn off my camera. Okay.
Yeah, no, I like it. I like the idea of kind of taking, being inspired by a piece, beginning similar, and then kind of branching up and doing your own thing. I like also that you've got the melody comes back simplified with chords, and then you've got, you're giving the left hand something to do. I think that that's a really nice kind of variety in your kind of texture here. And so for everybody that doesn't know, this little symbol that looks like a semicircle with a dot, it's in measure 5. So that's called a fermata. You see this a lot in music, even though we didn't talk about it. It's not really super important for theory's sake, but what a fermata does is it tells you to hold the note, and usually it's succeeded by a pause. So this is kind of like the music kind of stops and there's like a pause, and then coming back in forte and then changing the texture so dramatically, I think is a great way to kind of use a fermata to kind of create a natural separation in your music. Where it sounds like one follows the other, but it's not just so repetitive, like 1, 2, 3, 4 kind of rhythmically. So I also like that you have some hemiola, which is nice. So having the 2 feel against the 3 feel, you didn't use duplets, you used the dotted notes, which is fine. It's the same basic effect. And I like also how dissonant some things are. I like that you're not afraid to get a little crunchy with that. So yeah, were you planning to submit both, or were you kind of looking at either one?
That's the main like concern I have right now, because I don't know which one to turn it in. So
sure. I think yeah. the first one we listened to sounds, just for the sake of you finishing on time, the first one sounds closer to done to me. Mm-hmm. Like the first one, I could see it finishing up in like 3 or 4 measures. This one sounds like it's the very beginning of what could be a much longer piece. So it might be best to try to just work on that first piece, just okay, so you can don't spend the whole weekend.
I was talking with my mother, who's like a piano major, and when she heard this, she said, "This looks like a piece that should have like 16 more measures or something."
Yeah, this feels like the first 30 seconds of a 5-minute piece. The other piece sounds like it's almost over. So, yeah, just for your own sake, I would work on the first one. But no, this is really great. So I would definitely. Keep at this when you have the time, because this is really, really cool. Do you have any other questions about this one or the first one?
Not really. Other than the ending, the first one, like how to end, but you kind of answered that already. So
yeah. Yeah, no worries. Yeah, these both look like they're in really good shape. And I like the kind of variety in rhythm and texture and in kind of melody. I think you do a pretty good job of taking an idea and having it fill the entire piece without it seeming just like you're repeating the same thing over and over again. So you've done a good job in both pieces of that, I think. So great. Yeah, thanks, Daniel. Thanks for sharing. This is great. I see that we've lost a couple folks, probably because they have other classes, which is totally fine. We have been going for an hour, so I'm happy to call it here if all of you want to call it. Thank you so much for all of you who shared some stuff. These all look really great. I think that all these projects are coming along really well. And yeah, thanks for a great class. Thanks for being so consistent with coming to Zoom. If you haven't already, please take some time to fill out the evaluations. That would really help me and the TAs out a lot. And yeah, besides your final exam, which is due tomorrow, and your project, you're all set. So if you ever need anything, feel free to shoot me an email. You all have my contact info. I'm happy to help out with any music related questions you can have. And yeah, have a wonderful rest of your summer, even though it's not very much time, unfortunately. So great. Yeah, we'll call it there for today. So thank you all so much, and have a wonderful weekend.
Thank you.
Thank you.